Welcome. Today in Cruise 5, we are in Mchinji, Kaisa Inn to be specific, and we're here to meet a man who is the most celebrated, the most accomplished jazz producer, songwriter, and also singer, Erik Paliani. Welcome to the show.
Great. How are you, my brother?
I am fine. How are you?
Great.
What is this place?
This is where I'm hiding for now.
Hiding?
Yes.
I don't like the sound of that. I thought you were here to stay. Just hiding?
Well, look, there's a plan that I want to implement.
Okay.
And then before I could implement it, I wanted to be in a place where I can actually try it out.
Okay.
Because Malawi is kind of a unique place.
Yes.
So as much as you've done jazz all over in Southern Africa, mostly,
yes,
and a bit of out there in overseas, I wanted to implement a plan that can work for Malawians and not necessarily bring in a plan and enforce it on Malawians.
Okay.
So I think one of the best ways to do that was to come in and study the things that are happening.
Okay.
So a bit of a research. It's been about a year now.
Okay.
And I think the research is over. So I'm quite aware of what I can do and how I can contribute to the Malawian industry, but also align it with the world, which is one of my biggest ambitions.
We've traveled all the way from Lilongwe.
Yes.
Almost 2 hours
Meet you. Thank you very much.
Just so we can know more about you.
Great.
Where were you born?
I was actually born in Blantyre.
Okay.
And I think everyone who was born in Blantyre would say I was born at the Queen's Elizabeth.
Oh, so yeah, sure. I think that's probably the only sensible hospital that was there in those days.
Yeah, I was born in Blantyre on the 6th of September 1975. Yeah, so I'm a Blantyrean.
Yes, Blantyrean. Yeah. Where exactly were your parents this time?
At that point, I think my parents were staying in Mandala, which wasn't so far away from there.
All right.
And then I think, but where I remember as a young
growing up.
That's my childhood place. That's where everything started.
Yes.
Friendships.
Yeah.
Playing guitar.
Yeah.
Playing soccer. But also, if you remember, where now it's the Maone State.
Yes.
So that was like almost our playing field.
The jungle where you go and just do anything.
Discover life.
That young people do.
Exactly.
And how many were you in the family growing up?
We're only two.
Only two?
Yeah, and my sister, I think Penelope Paliani, she's also a journalist.
Ah. So they're only two in your family?
Just two of us. You know, at one point I was like, I hated it. And
yeah.
So sometimes I liked it.
What?
Sharing
we are in Africa, we're in Malawi, where we have got extended families, yeah. And although there might be two of you, there's always somebody in the family.
Yeah.
Was it just the two of you and your parents growing up, or there was always somebody in the family?
No, there was always an uncle visiting, aunts visiting.
Yes.
And, my mom was also very strong,
mm-hmm.
but she also worked for Red Cross. So she was more into, she came from a giving family, but
yes.
strong as well.
Yes.
So yeah, you needed to understand that the bed might be some visitor's bed tonight.
Aha. Uh-huh, okay. So I hated that. Because I mean, like, they'll say, okay, so you guys, you move.
Yeah.
Because we've got a visitor and he's gonna use the bed, and then you have to sleep on the couch or maybe on the floor.
Yeah.
Pampas up, and then you're like, when are they going?
Exactly.
You know, that kind of thing.
We grew up like that.
Exactly.
Yeah, so people passing by. But, but as a family, we were mostly, I'd say, with my uncle Sam.
Okay.
Who almost grew up, he was with us when to get married.
Okay.
So, but basically, a small family, but with lots and lots of loving relatives.
What was your dad doing at this time?
When we moved to Maoni, he had gone back to study law.
Okay.
He was a musician on one side.
Okay.
Running so many bands, which we'll get to that.
Yeah.
But then he was also eventually a magistrate.
Ah, was he?
So he initially worked for the Malawi News Agency as an editor.
Okay.
For a while. But I think with the moving and trying times of politics and journalism at that point, he decided to go back to Chancellor College and study law. So I think when I was like in standard one, I remember walking around the corridor and memorizing like cases. And, it was one of, I saw him really struggling.
So you grow up there and you're growing up as a kid, and I'm sure that's where you did your primary school.
Yes.
And then from there, how did things go? Where did you do your secondary? And then?
So I did a bit of, roaming around in those days. I did a bit of St. Kizito Primary School.
Yes.
Then I came to Lilongwe for a while.
Okay.
And did, I think, a year at Chiwoko when I was in standard 7 now.
Okay.
But then I went back to Mkologot primary on standard 8. And then from there I went to Kwezi secondary school.
Okay. That's up north.
Up north.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's where now I did my 4 years. I did a stint at Blantyre secondary school for a
while. Were you not dismissed at some point?
Yes.
Kicked out of school?
Unfortunately, yes.
What happened?
Big miscalculation. I had gone to Blantyre secondary school, getting in from 3, and then I think cultural differences. Praise was more like hustle, it was very tight.
Yeah,
people come from all over the place, but the hardships of the place and also the way the teachers kind of groomed the praise students, you were more like together.
Uh-huh.
So when I went to Blantyre secondary school, I think it was too free for me.
Yeah.
Then eventually, I think there was a day I didn't even go to study, but there was a teasing that had happened.
Yeah.
So the headmaster decided to dismiss all the guys that were not in class.
No, I don't know where you were. Maybe you were involved.
Well, I mean, it's a long story, man. but that's what we're still going to lay down today.
What happened at Blantyre?
Then I went back to praise secondary school.
There was teasing.
Yeah.
You were not in class.
No, I wasn't.
And they thought you were involved in the teasing.
Oh yeah.
And they had to kick you out.
All the people.
Were you involved in the teasing?
Not at that specific time. Never.
So after that, I understand you went to Zimbabwe to do your tertiary education.
Yeah.
Where exactly did you go to?
I went to Harare Polytechnic.
Okay.
I was doing a, what we call procurement.
Ah.
So I wanted to be a purchaser.
Never worked out, I think.
Look, it was an agreement with my parents.
So okay.
At that particular time, the bag of playing music had also kicked
it in. Had gotten.
Because I come from a family of musicians.
Yes.
So, well, there was one condition at home. Do at least a degree or a higher diploma.
Then
with that, you can go and become a musician if you want. So the idea was after that, I go to Zimbabwe Ethnomusicology.
Okay.
Where Waliko was also, Waliko Makala was also studying at the time.
Yes.
So he was studying at the Ethnomusicology. I was
you're doing the purchasing side of things.
Yeah.
So how long did you stay there?
Unfortunately, I did 3 years.
Okay.
And then my parents passed on.
Oh.
So life had to change.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's when I come back to Malawi now.
Yeah.
So in Malawi, I came back in 95 properly.
Yeah.
And I finished the purchasing with the chartered of purchasing and supply.
Okay.
Right here. And I actually got a very good teacher. I can't remember his name.
Yeah.
And I kept asking myself, why did I even go to Zim?
Yeah, this guy is good. Yeah, I could have just stayed.
Yeah, yeah. So after that, so I was doing that and also joined at the Acacias Band. So that's where now the music thing starts as well.
What you started in Zim wasn't really what you wanted to do, was it?
It was.
Yeah.
At that particular time, we could sense that music was becoming also corporate.
Yes.
Meaning that there was no one without a manager or without a business, like having a personal manager, have people that check your accounts, you know, people that are advising on what to do. So we could now, there were trends whereby we saw that people were becoming more of a musician and understanding the business side of music. So we didn't have any course that offered the business of music.
Uh-huh.
So we asked ourselves, so why I went to Zim was because in every course of business, whether it was business accounting or whatever you're majoring in Zimbabwe, they required you to do other business subjects. So even though I was doing like purchasing and supplying, I was doing business maths, I was doing business law, I was doing business English as well. So presentation of letters, how you deal with contracts, etc. So for me personally, it was actually a plan of empowering my music side. It wasn't actually not wanting to do that. It was a proper plan of saying I need that information so that I can also understand the business side of music.
That's a different approach because Gumara Gunotazambiri and Hoyim Bamakabuti, but that's what they do. Why woman called in go to a wimba and do a keyboard in the easy. Zama punziro, I'm on that would in the soap and cheat.
I'm saying any menu on the wood. Zina or casual.
Eh.
You won't garu him, Garungate.
If
you bang a wife, Unari before you would. Unari day in a memo and I'd consider business law. The guy does not understand investment. You need to get a guy who understands investment. Say, we had to do it. Yeah.
We're talking a jack of all trades today. I guess it's Erik Paliani. Let's talk music. What kind of music do you like? I know you are a jazz artist, but you must have been exposed to all kinds of music growing up.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of music did you grow up listening to?
My dad was a jazz fanatic and blues.
And
all aspects of jazz, so from swing
to
John Scofield, you know, my gadgets, so and also him also was a very good piano player, but a guitarist too. So on an outside, you know, my piece, I got a guy, my symphony number 6, sometimes we were guitarist, also was over. So I grew up also kind of, that was my early introduction to music. So I listened to a lot of blues, especially Hendrix, Jimi Hendrix,
that
we heard.
Yes.
A lot of George Benson.
George Benson.
Mm. he was also had a band called the Jazz Connection at that time.
The Jazz Connection.
So Richard Paliani and the Jazz Connection.
Ah.
So they were also practicing at home. Okay. So Mamba, so obviously that was my favorite band.
Yeah.
Ninye Mbozao Zinangeli Kanimu, which was also one of the famous tracks.
Yes.
Kumano, you know, when I used to love a lot of Malawian music,
and
it sounds pentagons.
Oh, yes, 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 yeah, yeah.
So, sounds pentagon, I band you off your
When you listen to his music now and what he says he used to play, I mean, the world's apart. What song would that be, the first song in this program?
Play me something from Richard Bonner.
Richard Bonner, oh my god, that guy is fantastic.
Yes.
Yeah, imagine Malefosi.
Yeah, I like him because he's an African who is not scared to show off Africa and himself to the world. And I think that's an approach we need to have as an artist.
Let's sample something from Richard Bonner in this program today.
You're so smooth, trying to get my good. I can't help myself, you make me act a fool. Sweet thing you say, it takes away your mood. I'll be so excited, babe, I don't know what to do. I really wanna be your only one. Forget about the rest of me. Why stop being good enough when you do not the best? Do you live with me? What I'm trying to say, or won't you stay? I stick with you. Baby, don't stop doing what to do. You don't see it.
Erik Paliani is a man who has grown up around music, and he is a musician in almost every aspect of that. How many musical instruments do you play?
I can comfortably say that I'm a guitarist.
Yes.
But along the way, I used to play good piano.
Yeah.
When I was younger.
Mm-hmm.
But then when I moved to South Africa, I saw some great piano players. I was like,
I think this is not
the way this guy is playing.
Yeah, so I play a bit of piano, a bit of bass.
Yeah.
But I'm a guitarist. That's what I am.
Moving to South Africa, how did that happen?
I joined the Cassius Band, as I said, in 95. Okay. So I did 95 and 96, about 98. And then I realized that we were famous.
Yes. You know,
the money was good.
Yeah.
But knowledge wise, yeah. I felt like I was not where I needed to be.
Okay.
So in those days, the options were either you hustle to the States, yeah, or London.
Yeah.
Or you can hustle on a bus.
Yeah.
To SA.
To South Africa.
So under my situation, then I saved up a bit of money.
South Africa.
And I decided, let me go to South Africa and see what's happening there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, I decided, I think late 98 to start kind of visiting South Africa on a test
team. Yeah. So you'd go on, come back.
3 months, I could only get 3 months visas.
Yeah.
Then. So then eventually, gradually, I penetrated South Africa.
Wasn't it difficult? Because, I mean, South Africa, compared to Malawi, is quite huge, and the music industry there is like tenfold bigger than Malawi. Yeah.
It was massive. It was one of the most toughest battles I ever took in life.
Yes.
Because in those days also we didn't have internet.
Yeah.
So we couldn't research properly. About,
so you didn't know what was going on there?
No, you were just going to the war.
You just go there, then you're like, oh my God, what did I get myself into? I wish I had known about this before I came.
Yeah, I know. So yeah, it took certain things that happened very pretty easy these days. It was one of those decisions that I just went. But then every challenge was what I was looking for. Because also South Africa gives you answers to problems.
Yes.
So as much as it's difficult to penetrate, there are ways we don't want to grind them and on Dalin Big Rage. Umatas won and when I saw money big rage manager, mom been a mala mods. It also taught me to be strategic about as to what I want in life.
And you ended up joining Reverend Benjamin Dube's band, which I think must have been phenomenal at that time, because Benjamin Dube, I mean, in this part of Africa, he's huge. Uh-huh. Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, from a contemporary point of view, Benjamin was the biggest artist then, and Joab.
Yeah.
So they were like kind of competing, you know, in terms of popularity.
The prominence.
But then, prominence, as you may put it, yeah. But then in terms of music, I was leaning towards Benjamin, you know, because he was still in those days still very semi old school American and South African tradition.
Yeah.
So that's what he was mixing. So blues featured a lot in this thinking. Now with my bluesy background, I think that was like the place I really felt perfect. Comfortable joy. Yeah.
Meeting Zamajobe. What was it like?
It was also at the time looking for opportunities, because she was she would visit the choir, so she's actually from the Benjamin Dube area. But then eventually she joined the Pop Idols and then became like number five. So they were looking for a producer to produce her album, even if she didn't win. I wanted someone to produce.
Okay.
So we had jammed a bit, obviously, you know, you jam and you have an understanding, you know, share the same likes like reggae, jazz, that mixture, African music. So yeah, so when they asked her who can produce her album, she said, man, I think this guy can do it.
Wow.
So that's how it started, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
How has the journey been like from that time? Because I think you produced, is that two of our albums or something?
Yeah, I did two of our albums, and also I was a music director in a band for quite a while. But very, very interesting, because when I started producing the first album, I didn't even know exactly what a producer's role was. So, like enough, but then, you know, computers had appeared.
Yeah, so you had the internet, so you always go and say, okay.
Research about my roles, you know, and like, oh, you put up a budget. How do I put it? Then eventually, also, that knowledge from
purchasing
came in,
I think I know what to do. I know how to do this. I know,
write a business proposal.
Yeah. This is what I need to do.
You need to do this way. Or that guy can write it for me, because I've seen his proposals.
Yeah,
I like his approach.
He's good at
things. I mean, I'm going to tell you about it. Because some of Tanzania is going to sank him. I'm going to tell you about it. For him,
I'm going to go to my church.
I'm going to go to my church.
I'm going to go to my church. This guy doesn't know how to do his thing. That's our guest today, Erik Paliani, in Cruise 5, our second song.
Startup of my career in South Africa.
Yes.
Well, there's a song that everyone kind of relates me with.
Yeah.
And that's Ndaweyandu, which I produced for the artist in Nation, Zamajobe.
Zamajobe. Ndaweyandu. So you've met them all. You've met Hugh Masekela, Themba Mkhize, Zamajobe, and these are great people that you have met. What is it like working with these people, meeting them in person? Because to some of us, they're just names, big names.
Yeah. I mean, I think as you go along in your musical career, you realize that there's the artistical side of a person, and then there's a personal side of a human being.
Yes.
So mostly you find that in with like Bry Hughes and them, very, very simple guys in personality.
Yeah.
You know, you can come here, in 5 minutes, you've been at the Boma.
Yeah.
You know, made certain friends,
he's
doing his thing. But once you work with them, you realize also they are very serious people that can come off their personalities to drive the art and the personality of the art. So Hugh Masekela, the artist, and Hugh Masekela, the person, they're not the same thing.
Totally
so when I'm on stage, I'm with Hugh Masekela, the artist, I'm working.
Yeah.
So I'm aware of him. He can even shout at me on stage.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's allowed because he's the boss
at that particular
time. It's business. And then after that, you know, if he needs to mention it, he'll mention it, but life goes on.
Yeah.
So that's one thing I learned also with meeting most of these stars is that they are extremely serious with their artistry.
But when you're on stage, my friend, that's your office.
Yeah. So funny here will be.
When you were in South Africa, so all you were doing was music? Or there was something else you were doing on the side?
It's been all music related.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's when I realized that you don't have to be a guitarist only. So I would produce. I was running a small studio, but also with my good friend Marvel Solomon. We're still currently running a small label called Maverick Sounds, but we're trying to, one of the reasons why I'm here is to ensure whether we can grow that small label.
Okay.
So that we call it more, something more African, and also it's more Southern African oriented. So I ran a bit of a record label. I did a bit of songwriting. So all the branches of music, that's what I would do. But in my earlier years to getting there,
hustling. Something to put Boros on the table.
Yeah, but it will be at a music shop. You know what I mean?
Did you learn any South African languages?
What guys?
Yeah?
Hey.
Like what languages?
I see Zulu as crewmate.
I didn't know what I
did.
Because for you to get by there, I mean, you just have to learn those languages.
Yeah, but also, I mean, I got to see the similarities with our own language.
Aren't they similar?
Yeah, so you find that once you look at it from a grammatical point of view, you find that the words are actually the same words, like nyama and nyama.
I'm not starving.
Yeah, I'm going to my wallet.
I'm going to eat. So they're quite similar.
It's the same.
But you've been quite in many places. We know Zimbabwe, you've been there, South Africa, Malawi, obviously. Where else have you been to? Where else have you lived? Like,
I did a bit of Botswana.
Okay. What was happening in Botswana?
I was hustling.
Hustling in Botswana?
That was before I went to South Africa.
That's the last place you'd want to go and hustle?
No, I wanted to hit South Africa from this angle.
Oh, so you went through Botswana, hustled a bit, and then poof.
It never went. So I kept that, and I decided to go straight. And then visiting a bit, you know, like, I've done quite a lot, like Namibia, you know, Swaziland, Lesotho, you know, and there was a time I did about 10 days in Tripoli.
Wow.
But I was lost.
Yeah.
It's another long story.
Why, you didn't know the language? Or?
No. I arrived there and no one came to pick me up at the airport. So I was the only African. You know, put it straight, I was the only black boy there. Dreadlocks and a guitar. And all Arab looking characters. So,
what? Yeah. And nobody was there to pick you. And then the language, I mean, it's not like you can know where to go.
There's always
you don't even know how to call a cab.
I didn't even know. There's a guy who's a taxi driver.
Yeah.
He came to me and looked in my eyes and said, "You lost." And he said, it's Ramadan, I come for you. After 10 minutes, you are lost. I'm like, hey, I'm not lost. So I tried all the...
You're trying to act up. At this time, you knew that guy was not coming. You were hoping that...
I thought the guys would come pick me up, but it never happened. Then the guy who was saying I'm lost is the guy who helped me a lot.
The taxi driver?
Yes.
So the taxi driver came to... What had you gone to Tripoli to do?
I was playing with an artist called Sutuka as a horse.
Okay.
Yeah, so a day before that, I was playing with those another artist in South Africa, Judith.
Yeah.
And then it was a government gig.
That Judith is Sepuma?
Yes.
Ah, okay.
So Judith and Sutuka agreed, no, we need the same guitarist. So I said, no, he can leave the next day.
After doing the show, he's going to come.
Uh-huh. So they went, Sutuka and them went earlier. And I had to join them through Egypt. I flew through Egypt into Tripoli. But then when I arrived there, there was no one.
How did you find your way home?
And I couldn't change my ticket. That was also a funny thing. It was one of those, it wasn't an electronic ticket, it was a actual ticket.
Yes,
you can't change those ones.
Yeah.
So I had to be there for the 10 days.
Never made it to the show?
I never met it. I met the guys like maybe 7 days later.
Oh my goodness!
I was like a proper Tripoli.
How did you survive all those days in Tripoli with nobody to talk to?
Well, I made friends eventually. Guitar and dreadlocks.
Really?
Work.
Then this has got its own language as well, I guess.
Yes,
so this spoke for you.
Yes.
And that as well, the dreadlock, it spoke.
For sure.
What language did the dreadlocks speak?
Peace.
How long have you grown this dreadlock for?
These are 11 years now.
11 years?
Yes.
Oh my God, that's a long time.
Yeah.
Ever thought of cutting it?
When time is right, I'm not really passionate about them.
Yeah,
it's part of me.
Yes,
I take care of them. But yeah, you know, I'm tying a dance in
Maturugira. What are the interesting things that you have experienced with your dreadlocks? I guess there must be stereotypes already. Like,
I mean, in South Africa, it's no one notices that.
Yes,
it's become part of there's the Rasta culture.
Yeah,
and also there's the natural African culture of embracing naturalness in terms of hair and presentation.
Yeah.
I was in Maputo last November.
Mm-hmm.
Hey man, every corner the police will stop you and search you.
Yeah. What were they looking for?
They'll be looking for, you know, at that point they said we have in Maputo there's a drug problem.
So they think when they see the dreadlock,
that was what they
probably
dreadlock.
Something in the pocket.
Yeah. So it's part of those. So you meet those kind of, you know, but they're also open ways. You know, sometimes you find that police are like, I'm not. So it depends. You know, you take it as they come.
Growing the dreadlock, was it about the Rasta thing or it was just about style? What exactly was it like? Because I know it can be, as you say, it can be interpreted differently.
It's more about being African.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my presentation of the true passions of an African.
Not Rastafarianism.
Part of Rastafarianism is African.
Are you a Rasta?
No.
Do you go to church?
That's a good question. When I have time, I pray. But I pray every time I play music. So there's a lot more spirituality in my music. But I come from, I've played at church, I know church songs. If there's a time, I'll pray. But yeah, I'm not a Rasta.
Growing up, yeah. Were you going to a particular church?
Yes.
As a young kid?
Yes.
What church was that?
The Worldwide Church of God.
The Worldwide Church of God?
Yes.
Growing up, you went to the Worldwide Church of God?
Yes.
And then you said, let me grow a dreadlock and then I can always pray.
And then I can still go back now. They don't have... The thinking of the church was amazingly empowering as well.
Okay.
Yeah, it was one church that encouraged you to be yourself.
Okay.
Music, that's where we could also play, read music. Oh. There was like a computer. The first time we tried to program.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we programmed there. But also, there was like a fire...
shooting.
Shooting
in church.
Target shooting, pallets.
Even
girls as well. So it's also
why would I find it peculiar?
No, it's just target shooting.
No, I mean why would the church be interested in people learning how to shoot targets and stuff like that?
I guess we are the soldiers of the department.
Who do you pray to when you're praying?
God.
God.
Yes.
Because I know the people who pray to their ancestors. Like, oh, she's looking and...
You know, as a jazz musician, spirituality is very simple. I was speaking to my sister, Joy, who preaches a lot as well, besides being a TV presenter. And I told her that, you know, when I play, and I'm talking about personality, I actually literally feel that thing. I call it that thing. And he says, I feel it also when I pray. It's like little, like a spark of spirituality. When you pray, come up with again, and I, like, takes you into another form. For me, playing guitar is extremely spiritual as well. It takes me to places where I can go also when I pray. So it's just not about entertaining people. Mm-hmm. But this is also who I am, spiritually, physically.
It's that serious?
Yes.
When you're playing?
Yes.
You feel a certain sense of spirituality.
Oh yeah, definitely. That's why this for me is a life, you know. Okay. And usually when you play music that doesn't empower your spirit, you can't get there.
Because it shows when you are playing the guitar, mm-hmm. the passion and the facial expressions, mm-hmm. you can see.
And you need to be careful of that world, because that world is. It's a very divine world.
Careful, Leon. What could happen?
Sometimes you can feel you're bigger than a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you can feel like you're too special.
Yeah.
That's why I was saying earlier, don't not forget to come back to reality and be a human. Well, these are gifts. It's like what you do as a TV man.
Yeah.
You can misdirect the whole world.
Yeah, the whole
world. So you're very careful about what you do in your career. But you put in your spirituality. I think that's also why you are in this job.
I think that there have been cases of artists who feel like, I think I'm no longer an ordinary human. I'm superhuman. Mm-hmm. I guess that's what you're talking about. Because you get lost in a certain world and you experience things. And then you come back and you're like, I think I'm not like them.
My wife said, Kizito, Nimao. But that's who you are, you know, and that's the whole.
You're just a human being.
So you go there, you praise, and then you come back, and then you've got other things to do as well.
Well, that's really deep, and that's what coming to in Cruise 5 today. A reminder: we're in Jinji at Kaesa Inn, just a few minutes away from Jinji Boma. Actually, a few more minutes away from Zambia.
Yes.
Do you ever cross into Zambia?
Oh yeah, Chipata. Yeah.
Chipata. You just literally walk into Zambia.
Chipata.
it's closer to go to Chipata, go grab bread than going to Lilongwe.
No, definitely.
And our guest today is Erik Paliani. Mm-hmm. He's a jazz artist, and as he's telling us, he's got a wide range of influences and can play a wide range of instruments. And let's see what kind of taste of music he has. What would be your third choice?
I'm looking for something Malawian.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And there's a couple of artists that I'm following locally that are doing great jobs.
Yes.
But I think there's a guy that I would love in the current state of mind.
Yeah.
Agoroso.
Agoroso. See, the first time I listened to that guy, I didn't believe that he was performing. Because I listened to him performing. I didn't listen to his music on the CD. Mm. I listened to him performing and I was like, I had to pinch myself. Say, this guy is right here. He's performing this kind of music. Because it was new. It was a fresh kind of thing.
No, agoroso means...
Agoroso. Agora agoroso means something big. So let's sample some agoroso.
Shai Mabasaku Runga Kwaku Pasa Manyajo Pana Kalaiwe Pana Fambaiwe Salonga Piamananga Maka na Maka Makana maka, mananga bebara. Punch it up, oh yeah. Malongira ko mapesa, oh manama, mananga kabe kwata peri nyanya, oh kamulo zaniwe mama.
This is Cruise 5, and today we're talking to Erik Paliani. He's a jazz producer, he's a songwriter, he is a singer in his own right. Spent quite a bit of time in South Africa and, of course, grew up in Malawi. And we just listened to a Malawian song, and some people say Malawian music doesn't have an identity. They say it has taken too much influence from other music genres so that you can't say this is Malawian music. What do you think about that?
It's a tricky question.
Eddie?
Because probably like an entertainment answer to that.
Yes.
But also there's a, you know, like a school, you know, music theory answer to it.
Yes.
From a music theoretical point, I think Malawian music is suffering because it's too ahead.
Yeah.
From what is happening. Meaning that it hasn't been diluted.
Oh.
Right. So if you look at traditional Malawian music, the melodies are so weird as we put it.
Yeah.
And yet when you study jazz, as you go further, you end up studying the same things. You go 4 years at UCT, on the fourth year, what they're teaching you is something that Malawians have been doing for years. So that journey is also a bit confusing for me to answer, is Malawian music that backward or not? But I think, in my personal view, the problem is that Malawian music is actually, in traditional sense, more especially, is too ahead to be understood in the current. But where the world is going, you find that slowly, Tamba one for Saint Antonio. That's why we can also take Nyimbo Gadikwacha Kwaira, Chitukutu.
Yes.
And then we are, even us, we're trying now to put the theory that it's kind of new. Because the songs historically are older than the theory that we are applying to translate the song.
Yes.
So in my view, on the traditional sense, Malawian music is actually ahead, or is actually equal to the musicians, traditional musicians of Cuba, traditional musicians of Algiers, and traditional musicians of Mangoes. In the contemporary sense, we are not digging much from these guys that are ahead. That's why we are now in a dilemma of looking at what has been famous now from whether it be Nigeria, South Africa, and adding on to a bit of our music. So in my view, it's a very tricky question.
It is.
Yeah.
To bring it down to reality, to what is happening now, what I find exciting as a music lover is that there are young people who are trying to fuse the traditional beat with the pop beats that we've gotten accustomed to.
Yes.
And it's working.
Oh yeah.
Because the songs are now popular.
But I think you need to balance the two.
Yes.
You can't just have music that is true traditional, you know, too hardcore.
Yeah.
But you also need to have music that is popular. You need to get the elements of the hardcore into the popular.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you've, at one way, you will connect.
Yeah.
A guy who's listened to popular music at one point wants something harder.
Yeah.
And also a guy that has been listening to heavy music at one point wants to be relaxed, eventually at 2 o'clock, we just want to hear, you know, Agamwili.
Yeah.
And then have fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a balance. And I think it's important to make sure that both are taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can't have a pop world without a hardcore world.
Jazz music, as a genre, do you, when you're performing to the Malawian audience, and I've seen you perform before, do you think the Malawian audience understands your music?
Over the years, things have changed. I remember when I started these performances, and I think Zodiac has a couple for the 2000, somewhere back, where it was just three of us trying to introduce the idea. And then you could play, and then you play 3-4 songs. And I remember playing at Little Theatre, and I opened my eyes, and I was like, no,
this is not working.
We are getting too deep.
Yes.
So we kind of we tell each other, let's sweeten it up. But over the years, this year has been interesting, because I won't talk about the bigger gigs that I did.
Yeah.
But me and Danny Sewal, we are actually there's a small bar in Area 49.
Mm-hmm.
Let me not get the name wrong, but I think it's Fat something.
Mm-hmm.
But where he's been playing, and it's just a normal bar. And the reason why we went there was we wanted to taste how far can Malawians take jazz.
Yes.
But the chaos that goes there, even playing a hard song like Take Five,
yeah,
you find guys are getting into it. And now what is happening is what I've been looking at it. Because once we play this, and we put in the traditional sense, you find that a guy is now dancing nyao on this jazz.
Yes.
And that was my whole mission.
Ah.
So Malawians are hip, man.
Yeah.
They will get this. They're getting it.
They'll get it.
Yeah. In actual sense, they have it. Remember I said to you, traditional Malawian music is not far away from...
It's not far away from what everybody else is singing.
Yeah. It's actually slightly even ahead. because the times are, you know, when you look at musical things, Malawi time is very complex. Mm-hmm. In modern times, just 4/4.
Yes.
Malawi time gets to 6/7/8, wow. 12/8. Yeah. You know, sometimes it's like a phrase, it's a time.
Yeah.
So it's, if you were teaching at a college, you only bring the Malawian songs like to maybe master students. That's how complex our music is.
You performing, I know you performed at major gigs. Tell me about the places you've been to and you're like, wow, this was massive. Just look back at your career and the things that you've done.
In every moment, you're right, it has its own moments that you
it's
remember.
It's got its own magic.
The first gig I remember was we were playing at the Lilongwe community grounds.
Uh-huh.
This should be about 92.
Yes.
We had a small young group called the Hot Kids.
The Hot Kids.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And at that point we had a friend also, Charles Jouet.
Yes.
He was still a
singer. Yes, yes. Yeah, I know Charles Jouet.
Yeah. So that was Aleluya Band had brought in the first equipment from Italy.
And, yes.
Big man Paul Band was there.
Yeah.
So that was the first gig we ever played as young kids to a whole big, you know, stadium with great equipment.
Yeah.
So that gig was like the beginning point of, it stayed in my mind. I was like, so this is how it feels like.
Yeah.
You start.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah. We feel all this.
And then Acacias also had some great gigs.
Yes.
South Africa. Recording for Every Mountain with Benjamin Dube.
Yes.
That was also interesting.
Fantastic.
There's lots, you know. But
I can
if
imagine.
I can fast forward, the show that a lot of people talk about, the show with Hugh Masekela at Lugano,
mm-hmm.
that was good, was also, it taught me how quickly Europeans can do a production. Was the actual footage of that show and recording, we got it straight after the recording.
Wow.
So like they do online. So they
wow.
Our engineer is mixing the gig, he's sending back to where the guys are recording it, and one is online mixing the recording.
Jeez.
And then but literally by 5 minutes, once you're done off stage, the guys
it's ready.
Yeah, it's ready. So that recording, I've had it like 5 minutes after that the show.
That's unbelievable.
So that was, for me, was like wow.
This
you
can
see
also
teamwork. You see cameras, like everything coming all together, but real time. Yeah.
Do you get nervous getting on stage?
Oh yeah, definitely.
You do?
Yes, I like that. I mean, that's what pushes the gig.
Oh, does it?
Like the greatest gig. That was another good gig.
Yeah?
Way, yeah.
Yeah.
Because it was like first time I played back at the township in, you know, after a while. And,
yes.
The reaction was good.
You get there and you're like,
yeah.
I just have to deliver with this kind of expectation.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, the nerves. There's a saying in our world that when the nerves die, that's the end of your career. Yeah, but the nerves are the
rocket. They're the drivers.
Yes. It's while you're maintaining the nerves, that's what makes you even play, choose the right notes. Don't overplay, don't over, you know, do things at the right time. So yeah.
Do you listen to your own music?
By the time I release it, I've heard it so many times. So not after the release.
Yes.
But eventually, like after a year. I mean, I'm loving the Chitukutuku album here.
Oh yeah, that was
because I recorded that side for, you know, thinking
that
of Malawi.
That was a masterpiece.
So when I play here now, and also I'm in a, I'm recording, I'm, you know, writing a new album.
Yeah.
So I'm getting into that. I'm listening to what I did a lot. I listen to it, and sometimes I don't want to listen to it, but then I can switch.
Yeah.
I can become a listener.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And listen to your music. And you just stumbled upon a certain old record and like, let me listen to this.
Yeah. Or if someone is listening to you, I can listen to it.
Yeah.
Yes, I can listen to it.
The inspiration to do music,
mm-hmm.
the songs that you write,
mm-hmm.
where does that come from?
I'm always trying to put literature, poetry, ideology into what I'm doing.
Yes.
So like the first album was mostly about, you know, thinking of home,
mm-hmm.
but then showing home to friends and then translating home, but they've never been there.
Yes.
So that's why Chitukutu itself makes sense.
Yeah.
Because it's like you are alone.
Yeah.
You came with a lot of people.
Yeah.
So the whole point was Malawi out of Malawi, what would it be?
Yes.
So it's very imaginative.
Yeah.
The streets are four-way, the street lights, it's solar in the villages. Mm. It's what I think Malawi should be in the next, should be now, or should have been, or will be in the next 20 years, mm-hmm. whereby you don't have to be in town to see lights. Mm-hmm. You know, if you, I'm in a village now, so I see there's a lot of progress happening in the village.
Yeah.
Solar is kicking in.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a guy who's, there's a pub up the road. The guy is just on. I don't know where, I don't even know where he's getting the electricity from.
You're like, dude.
Yeah, I know.
So, you're not part of.
So the record was about that imaginative world of Malawi. So even like the guys that are playing, they're very sleek over the Malawian song.
Yes.
Yeah, it's Malawi, bourgeoisie Malawi, it's rural Malawi. Mm-hmm. It's just that story, man.
So let's get to our fourth song now.
Let's hear a bit of Bob Marley, man.
Hey.
You know, growing up in the 80s as a young kid.
See, we had an interesting debate with someone.
Yes.
Bob Marley and Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
Shash and Dindan.
Onse.
Maunaso.
Because I'll tell you why.
What?
They're completely different people.
Hey, maybe we're going to catch Shash up more to a minute.
Imagine. When are
they? Apples and oranges.
They're in the same team.
Bob Marley. I was Shash and Bob Marley.
Yeah. Michael Jackson isn't Bob.
That's a question.
But personally, if you ask me personally, Shash Wabonda.
I think that's the thing, it depends on who you're asking. Shasha Ninani.
To you.
It's an age old question.
It's not the same question.
Who's the greatest of them all?
Who's good between Bob Marley and Peter Tosh?
Yes.
You know, that causes.
Hey, no. That's a battle. That's a battle. You know, anyway, let's suffer some Bob Marley now. So get up and stand up.
Please.
Yes.
Stand up for your rights.
Yes, yeah, stand up for your rights.
We're gonna stand up for our rights. So you better get up, stand up, look it.
Get up and stand up. That's almost like a political song. Because I mean, the message, the ideology is about people standing up for their rights.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Do you ever get political in your music?
I mean, I'm a musician. Every musician, I cannot run away from politics.
Yeah.
We are political. We are affected by political decisions. Mm-hmm. But I'm not a politician as to who do I vote for, which side I lean to, as we say. I'm more into that, especially. I'm more excited that people need to understand their basic rights. Mm-hmm. And I want Malawians to know, you know. There's a joke I always tell here that here I can wear a camouflage and wear like a sirigari. And I'm passing over from there because people don't even know when you can be arrested or where you can't be arrested.
Yeah.
So there's a lot, I'm a bit concerned at the understanding of the basic human rights of people. In comparison to a country like South Africa, for instance, even a drunkard understands his rights. You won't even arrest him just because he's drunk. He'll be calling out the constitution. You can't arrest me based on this. My rights, and you know. So it's for me. It's about you gotta stand up and know your rights, so that you can also even you can even vote well when you understand your rights.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we used to be getting excited a bit when we were young in standard six, career civics.
Yes,
they taught us about our rights, but not only our rights as such, which is something that we only talk about now.
Yeah.
But most importantly, what are your duties as a citizen?
Exactly.
So we grew up understanding your rights. You have to balance your rights and your duties.
What do you like about Malawi as a country?
It's like an untapped gold. You know, we're not operating out of full potential, and we will get there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is a place where one can bring out new ideologies to empower the people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, new ways of farming are new.
Yeah.
You know, organic farming is still new, or we remember it. You know, so this is for an investor, for a teacher, for a guy, a hustler.
Mm-hmm.
This is the place to be. Mm-hmm. You know, if that's a word. So on the negative side, as we're saying, we need to be able to be competitive.
Mm-hmm.
As we speak now, the world is competing.
Yes.
The Zambians are competing with us. Let's not hide about it. That's why they build bigger roads than us, or that's why they do something and amplify it.
Yeah.
Be it in soccer, you know, that's why there's competition. Even in what we do, you know, every time I tell them, like, I'm from Malawi, I play jazz, is there jazz in Malawi? You know, so that's a competition.
Yeah.
And it's something that we need to do, and we need to... Let's be competitive.
Mm-hmm.
Even how you do the program.
Yeah.
You guys, you know, when I watch the TV, sometimes I don't even know whether I'm watching Yabu Kenya,
Yaboni,
or I'm watching El Salvador. You guys are being competitive.
Yeah.
The gear that you guys brought here,
since
you got to,
thank you. Yeah.
It's about being competitive. And I think sometimes as Malawians, we are happy to lose.
Yeah.
Or just to be in the middle.
We are resigned.
Yeah, we need to change.
No, it's okay. Yeah. It's okay.
Yeah.
Mango vanga
jwancho. Where you are as a Malawian alone, you need to shine extra.
Mm-hmm.
And because you're carrying everyone that will come as a Malawian after you.
So you are here now in Jinji at this inn.
Mm-hmm.
Are you here to stay or are you just passing by? Because you're a true son of Africa. You seem to like moving from one place to another.
The struggle goes on.
Yeah.
You know, and the struggle I had forgotten Malawi for years.
Yes.
You know, so the most important thing is I wanted to establish a place where I can work from. And also be able to invite my friends to my home.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my friends, especially after playing the Chitukutuku album, they kept on saying, man, we play this music, but we've never been to your house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we haven't been. I want to play this music for Malawians.
Yeah.
So one of my biggest ambitions is to make sure that Malawi is a place that we can bring jazz artists. They'll be teaching, but they can also record their albums. So in the next 2 years, we'll ensure that the gear that we have is world-class gear, that you can invite Hugh Masekela or anyone else and say, look, on your next album, come and record here. But also use the facilities that we have. We've got great singers. We've got one of our friends, my name is Mr. Gideon. He's my African drummer.
Yeah.
I watch Ankumbale. But it's to get the guys to come and play. You know, I'm trying, personally, I'm trying to cut the nonsense of what I went through, carry a guitar, go rush into a place where you didn't know and then take so many years to know. If I did that, I don't want to see another youngster do that.
Doing that, so if you, going if, somewhere if to make the, it in life. The more you let them do it right here. It.
If you want to go out there, it must be because you want to, you are bigger than anyone, mm-hmm. or that's just what you want, mm-hmm. but not as a necessity. Mm-hmm. So it's to bring more of the education here. Obviously, there's when I'm here, the Zambia is also calling.
Yes.
You know, so.
Oh my God, and so, so close.
Yeah,
so jeez, we need to get worried. Maybe we need to pull you further into the country because you're so close to Zambia here. It's like one leg and phew, you're in Zambia.
Yeah.
That's not safe at all.
No, it is. Right?
So we are in your studio. Mm-hmm. Have you used this studio before, like recording an album or something?
We're doing some trial albums.
Okay.
We're recording Dan.
All right.
Dan Swale, the home.
Dan Swale.
Yeah, there's a young, another artist called Chimwebe Pidi.
Yes.
That has done a couple of songs. But mostly what I'm doing here is to write also my new album, which has to be released next year.
It's been a while, eh?
Yeah. So,
it's been a while.
And this one is a bit tricky because I'm actually going extremely more jazz as well as electric power.
Yes.
Yeah, so half of it I'm trying to record it. I'll bring some friends over the side.
Okay.
From South Africa. Uh-huh. And then also we'll take the files that side.
Yeah.
We'll get some local South Africans to do as well.
And this room, I mean, it's full of history. It's full of memories, I'm sure. Is there any particular picture that is a special space in your heart?
And weirdly, most of these pictures are Kimba's pictures.
Okay.
But the picture I requested was that one.
It's, yes.
It's his mother.
Okay.
And she's dancing chitere. So that one I requested, that was here we are doing more jazz on a chitere point of view. That one really truly is, it's got a beautiful smile. It's Malawi jazz.
Yes.
When I look at that picture.
Yes. Fantastic picture.
Yeah.
We need to wind up now.
Yes.
And I've got a set of questions that I'd like to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
I can only allow you to answer yes or no to those mm-hmm. questions. The only first question that you have to answer in full is, you tell us your full name.
Yes.
What's your full name?
Tendai Erikson Paliani.
Do you have any tattoos?
No, not yet.
Do you have any piercings?
No.
Do you have children?
Yes.
Have you ever shot a gun?
Pallet guns, no. In comparison to pallet gun, no.
Like a proper gun?
No.
No. Have you ever cried over someone?
Yes.
Have you fallen in love before?
Yes.
Have you killed a chicken before?
Yes.
Have you gotten into a fight before?
Yes.
Have you gotten any surgeries?
Minor one, yes.
Minor one. Minor surgeries. I'm okay with that. Because it's just yes or no, so you don't have to tell us about it. Have you ever been hospitalized?
Oh, yeah.
Have you donated blood?
Yes.
Have you ever smoked weed?
Yes.
Have you ever drunk alcohol?
Yes.
Have you broken someone's heart?
Yes.
Have you had a crush on someone?
Yes.
I guess we end it there.
That's it.
But about the family, I never asked if you've got a wife and children.
I've got children.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you don't have a wife.
Not yet.
How many children do you have?
I got two.
You got two children.
Mm-hmm.
And how old are they?
It's 12 and 2.
Okay. Mm. Now that's a huge gap then.
Yes.
What was happening in between? Music?
Studying music.
So two, are we waiting for another 10 years before?
No. These two are into music, so they're enough. you can predict, you know. But for now, those are really, they touch my heart.
Mm-hmm.
They're enough. Let me bring them home, see yeah. home, and then see what happens.
Are you looking at getting married at any point?
Every person looks at that.
I think
as you grow, you need to get your
person. So the options are still open?
As a human being, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's Erik Paliani, our guest today in Cruise 5. And as we wind, I've got a little challenge that I'd like us to do. You are a musician,
yes.
And I would like to think that I can do one of your favorite songs, which is Chitukutuku.
Uh-huh.
Can we play that song?
Let's try that.
Fantastic. So we're going to do Chitukutuku with Erik Paliani now. It's Yao, isn't it?
It is Yao. Yes.
What is the song saying?
It's all about, as I was saying, chitugutugu. I'm alone.
Yeah.
Sigeregiga.
Sigeregiga. I'm all alone. I'm left alone.
In a foreign land.
Yes.
You know, what you want in Pangari. All the young friends.
Yeah, I've gone.
Either they are dead or goodbye.
Ah, it's such it's a nostalgic song.
Yeah, it's very nostalgic. So he sees chitugutugu ni gambala.
Oh, it's a bird. Okay.
Pearl.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So that sound was reminding. It wasn't. I didn't dance like I'm going to ask somebody. Well, you know, I'm going to ask somebody. So I didn't go in. I'm going to ask. So that bird reminds me of.
But this is a Yao song. Do you speak Yao, like, or you just had to learn Yao for the song?
At home, we are not very far away.
Okay.
My mom is a Kamesa.
Okay.
From Malawi.
Yes, yeah.